clock tower.
And clock tower.
The one with
Scissor,
with the
was
doll.
Scissor Man. Oh, I think that's Clock Tower 2. I believe it's 2, Curse of the Doll or something like that.
Yeah. And I remember the first time I ever seen that. I never even played it. I just watched you play it when I was pretty young, man. Like 6.
Traumatized early.
Yeah, young man. And that was one of my first nightmares that I ever had was about that doll.
Michael!
Don't be so scared.
Stop!
Totally understandable, man. Like, the first Clock Tower was one of the first horror games I ever experienced. I watched a friend of mine in middle school play the first Clock Tower, and I was petrified for him watching it, because it was just this giant scissor man coming around. Like, is a point and click game, and I think all of them were. They were point and click horror games.
Yeah.
But like, you just hear the ka-chish, 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 and he can pop up from literally fucking anywhere.
Yeah.
And that point and click gives you that dread that you get, like, clicking like a motherfucker. You're like, go, 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 go.
Yes. God, fuck.
Like, it's, like, simple but effective.
Right. What I was going to say earlier, one of the things that is immersive and scary about a video game compared to a movie, a movie can just scare you, boom, like, in an instant. But a movie can't replicate the fear of running away from something in a video game. You know what I mean? Yeah. Those moments in horror games where you're running from something, that's when your adrenaline is pumping. Yeah. Your heart's racing. You're like, oh my God, I don't want to get fucking caught.
Down there. You're not one of them, are you? Quick, get in the dumb waiter if you want to live.
Why are you running?
Like, there was a game called Monstrum. It's been out for a few years, but god damn, it was horrifying. Like, that, it's like, you, like, chase sequences, like, when you want, you really don't want something to get a hold of you. Those are the biggest, like, those are the scariest moments to me in any horror game, is the chase.
Yes.
Like, because most likely it you're always going to feel like you're running in a dream. But you're like, whatever it is always faster than you.
Yeah.
Always faster than you. You're gonna feel like you're running through the ocean.
Yes, yes. You're gonna be, and another thing that makes horror games so scary, your vulnerability.
Mm-hmm.
Horror games, and this is the reason why a lot of people would say that
really good
Resident
ones.
Evil turned more into an action series. Because as it went on, Resident Evil 5, like, you had more ammo. You know, ammo was everywhere. Like, you didn't have to worry.
Herbs were everywhere. You could heal easy. You could replenish your ammo easy. It's not about as survival as much as it is just like, pow, 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 pow.
Yep.
You're not worried about survival anymore. The earlier Resident Evil titles made you feel helpless.
Yes.
Made you feel helpless. And that's what I think that's a mark of a lot of good horror games, is if they can establish that feeling of hopelessness.
Yes.
In a horror game, that's a key element, I would think, is... Man, I don't, like, if I go into it, I'm like, yeah, I'm going to beat this motherfucker. I'm going to come out this clean on the other side.
It's not
scary. That's not scaring me. But if I'm going into it, like, trepidatious, like, and just, you know, feel like I'm walking on eggshells throughout the entire game, because I'm like, I don't want to startle this. Even though you're like, you know, it's going to be programmed to be there. You're like, in your head, you're like, maybe I could do something about it. Hopelessness sets in. You're fucked. You're fucked. It should establish an air of despair and hopelessness and just whatever it is. I mean, like, it's not a horror game, but a game like Dante's Inferno sets such a good tone for what hell feels like.
Yeah.
So multi-layered, so demented.
Yeah.
Just like an endless, feels endless, feels like true despair, feels like a true void of hopelessness. Like, you just, you know what I mean? Like, you get my point. I'm beating a dead horse.
No. I mean, you're right. Like, hopelessness. Like, I mean, Outlast is one of those games to me that is terrifying because you're vulnerable. You're always running from something. And I was going to go somewhere with that specifically. But there's one point where, like, you know, you get caught by this guy who, mm-hmm. of course, you're running from. You get caught and everything, and it's just like a cutscene. And, like, I can't remember exactly what happens, but he ends up actually, like, cutting your hand off. You Jesus know what I mean? Christ. He, like, actually, and your character's, like, writhing in pain, and you somehow get away. But it's like...
That gives me, like, some House of Wax flashback.
I'm just playing as a guy who got his fucking hand cut off. You know what I mean? Can you get any more vulnerable?
Yeah, like, that's just... Like, hey, man, hate to kind of kick you when you're down. You gotta lose some fingers, bro. You might lose a hand. The game that probably made me feel the most like that hopelessness is The Suffering. You talk about a hopeless feeling when you're set in a prison, like a horror game that is set in a prison where a tornado or a hurricane or something kills the power. It's like Alcatraz style. The prison's on an isolated island to itself. So you're on an island where the storm has destroyed the electricity and these like alien-like demonic forces are in this prison stalking and just fucking ripping into prisoners that are around trying to survive this shit itself. And it's like, it's already one thing to try to escape a prison because there's already like, you're trapped for life, right? If you're in a penitentiary place like that, that's on an island, like an Alcatraz, you're there.
There's no escape.
There's no escape. It's meant to be unescapable because even if you escape the prison, you still have all this ocean to get through. All this big body of water. Good luck drowning. Or good luck not drowning, sir. Just deal with that. So, and the character you're playing as, he's in prison for murdering his infant child and his wife. But he doesn't remember it.
Oh, man.
So, and the game has multiple endings. So
weird
depending on
psychological element to mm-hmm. it as well.
So like, are you even playing as a fucking person that's even worth saving? Like even, but that's right. If he was bad, like depending on your ending, you find out what happened to them. And I think depending on the ending you got was what actually happened. So either he might've killed them or somebody else might've killed them, but like he didn't remember any of it. It was like, he's blacked out and the next. And he knew he was like, he's going to prison because his family was dead, found him dead. I don't know, man. It's a great game. Even The Thing. I love The Thing.
I was thinking of that.
Based off the movie.
Yeah.
I thought that was a great game just because the element of like you not knowing who's infected with it and when they're going to turn on you. You had everybody had trust meters
yeah.
or something, like how much you could trust this person on your team versus the other one. Like you'd be suspicious of them, like they're going to turn any time. And if they did, they were hard as fuck to kill. Flamethrowers was
awesome.
Like, you had to have flamethrowers usually, otherwise you wouldn't kill these fuckers. And I'm so happy that I have a PS2 that works, because I think that will be what I do for the rest of my Halloween.
Fuck
is
yeah.
I will play The Thing and maybe actually try to beat it.
Hell yeah,
it's
dude,
a day off
fun.
From work. I think that would be great as fuck,
dude.
To even, like, God, talk about a trip down memory lane.
Nostalgia, and let me tell you something also, playing horror games gives you that feeling that you want when you play a video game. You want to be engaged. You want to be immersed.
Yeah.
You want to have an emotional response. We have talked about on the show before and personally that sometimes gaming nowadays, it's hard for us to get into.
Can't connect to it like we used to.
Yeah.
And I want to partially blame age and just growing up as part of that. But at the same time, games really do feel way larger now than they ever did. Mm. And they lose that intimacy.
mm-hmm.
along the way somewhere.
But horror games, they're so tight. They're so intimate. They're not multiplayer, most mm-hmm. of them. They're just you and
it's meant fear. To be a singular experience, man. It's not meant to be shared with other people. Mm-hmm. Unless it's like a zombie slayer type game, you know what I mean? Yeah. But that's different.
Which, by the way, Left 4 Dead, one of the greatest horror games of all time.
Gross!
Ew!
What the hell?
Left 4 Dead is great.
Not if, scary, if you
wanna,
though.
That's what I'm saying. If you want to consider it horror, it's a shooter, but yeah. it's with horror elements.
Yeah.
Might be a more appropriate way to say it. Not to say that it can't scare you, because I've been jump scared by it. Just like random mm-hmm. special infected.
Yeah.
That you couldn't hear them, but all of a sudden you're pounced.
Yeah.
Or all of a sudden you're being wrapped up like, oh, fuck, I didn't even know you were there. You dirty bastard. It's like being like snuck up on by somebody with a fucking, like, I don't know, a power missile on Twisted Metal or some shit.
I was going to mention Twisted Metal, too. It's not a scary game, but definitely a horror atmosphere.
It's a dark game. Like, the further they went along, like, the character development that they tried to instill for some of those characters in Twisted Metal. Like, God, dude, there's no happiness in any of this. This is all, like, yet again, hopelessness. All these people are competing to get one wish. One wish granted from this twisted motherfucker named Calypso.
Who always ends up giving you your wish in some fucked up way.
Yeah, he will give you your wish, but in the exact worst way imaginable.
Yeah.
It's like, I can't remember. One of them was probably the most prominent one that sticks out in my head is Twisted Metal Black. Because that's when they started actually fucking with the characters a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Was, I think the character Outlaw was going, accidentally had killed a kid, like in a sniping, like a hostage situation, and shot the kid by accident instead of the person. But he got his wish to redo it and undo what he had done.
I made sure every single bullet found the right target this time. That dirtbag went down like a puppet with his strings cut.
Terrorist is down. Terrorist is down. Great shooting, agent. Second team, move it.
But it wasn't over. Not until I knew those people were safe. They were shaken but alive. Calypso had done it. I never thought it could be like...
All units, target is knocked down. Target is still hot.
I was so close to making it right.
Agent Stone, report in. Are you hit?
He ended up getting killed.
Right.
All the people in Twisted Metal Black are in asylums. That's where their stories are being told. Fucking Mr. Grimm, the guy who, he always had a skeleton head in the previous games, but in that version of the game, it was a man who wore a skeleton face over his own face.
Yes.
And it was his friend who he ate while, I guess, they were being held as POWs in war.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. So, and he had flashbacks of like his eyes and like guts laying there. And he's like, yeah, I think it was the best in the franchise.
For sure. Absolutely.
Like, because, oh, fuck, dude, could you imagine if you had like the Saw writers who created those traps also working on like these types of story backgrounds for these characters on top of the people that already were working with them in the past? I feel like that would be a fucking sick team.
Also, dude, it, like, as a movie, Twisted Metal, you would know that only one of these characters is going to make it.
Mm-hmm.
You'd get to know all their backstories, but only one can have that wish.
And all these stories are so dark and morbid and just awful. I mean, Twisted Metal, fuck, Sweet Tooth was a murderer. He was a serial killer.
As I fried, he started screaming out like the freak he was. He asked God to curse me, to burden me forever with the flames of hell. It took me less than a minute to kill three police officers and get my mask back on. I never used to believe in curses, but it's been 3 months since that night, and the pain gets worse every day. So let me tell you something, boys and girls. I sure as hell believe in curses now.
Whom had his head set ablaze by a priest to stop his fucking bloodlust-ridden urges to kill people.
Do you think he was a juggalo?
He probably was, man. He probably listened to my acts way too many times.